Okay. Hello, my name is Xuan Cha. I'm a PhD student in visual media lab, and today I'm gonna present about SCORE, a very brief overview about SCORE and SCORE-based models, which is related to current diffusion models. My attempt was to also cover about current diffusion models, but I think I would not be able to because I did not fully understand about the concept yet, but at least I think I would be able to introduce some of the high-level concepts about SCORE and SCORE-based model. So I may ha deliver some wrong knowledge, so if you know some correct knowledge, you can freely interrupt and correct my knowledge. Okay, so let's begin. For the contents are as follows. First, I'm gonna do some brief introduction about generative models, and I'm gonna tell you about introduce you about present about the SCORE and SCORE models. And also then I'm gonna tell you about sampling from SCORE models to generate new data, and then I'm gonna tell you about some controlling this sampling procedure using SCORE-based model. So for the reference, I looked into these papers and websites. So for more details, I recommend you to look into this link, and also you can freely check out through Google or ChatGPT. So first, for the generative model. So in previous and until now, the goal of generative models was to learn the data distribution in order to sample a new data based on the data set. So the basic goal was to estimate a specific, I mean, approximate some kind of parameter that could able to produce a data set which has a probability density function is similar to the ground truth data. So for this objective, one used like minimizing the difference between generated data distribution. In here, I wrote noted as P hat X and the ground truth data distribution as a PX. So these are the methods that try to introduce or research about this kind of produce generative models using this kind of loss terms or energy terms, which is autoregressive model, UAEs, EBMs, and normalizing flow model. And another way of training a generative model is to make the generative model, I mean, the network learns the data distribution implicitly by in adversarial manner. So the best, I mean, the well-known approach is GANs using generator and discriminator to make an adversarial loss, and thereby generator learns to produce some feasible, plausible data, which is similar to the ground truth data. And there are some problems. For the first, minimizing the difference between the generated data distribution between the ground truth and the generated data is about tracking the normalizing constant. And it has been a well-known problem, as well as it relies on surrogate objectives since we do not know the exact probability density function of the ground truth data. And for the GANs, they're kind of unstable in training, as well as very prone to mode collapse. So since they're only, how should I say, competing with the generator and discriminator itself, the generator's goal is to only trick the discriminator to make it, fake it to believe it as a real. So it's kind of prone to mode collapse. So for the alternative goal is to learn the score of the ground truth PDF instead of learning the PDF itself. And that is the basic goal of SCORE-based model. And it turns out it is quite effective. And in current days, it kind of beats the GAN quality literally. So it's kind of a popular method. So the basic idea for this diffusion model is a score. So I'm going to cover what is a score means and what is score-based models do and how do we train them and so on. So score and score model. What is score? Do you know what the score means?
Gradient of log-likelihood.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Actually, I thought nobody would answer, so I tried to cover some of the knowledges. But as Jonghyun said, yeah, it's a gradient of log likelihood function respect to the parameter vector. And for the base paper, which introduced the idea of the using score to find some or evaluate the distribution of the estimated data and the granted data, they kind of seems to interchangeably use between log probability density function and log likelihood density function. So for the brief recap, the probability density function and likelihood is kind of a similar, but it's kind of different in a manner of interpolating the calculation itself. So yeah. So I asked some details about this to the ChatGPT, and the ChatGPT said that there is a definition overlap between likelihood function and continuous random variables are often defined as algebra, blah, 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 blah. So if you want some more details, I recommend you to find. So I'm not gonna cover the details about why there's interchangeably using probability density function or likelihood, but as a in short, it seems that there is no much difference, and it's kind of often used to interchangeably use between those two. So I'll just move on for this part. So anyway, the score is a gradient of log probability density function here, respect to the parameter vector. And for the 1D example, it would be like this. So if the left side is a probability density function, and the right side is a score respect to the PDF. And yeah, that was a simple visualization. And it's another visualization for 2D data. And now, what is score model? Score model is literally a network, neural network that predicts the score. Then what would be the what is the difference compared to the previous generative networks? So first, previous networks tried to learn the data distribution itself. So we optimize the parameter theta of a function f, which its PDF would approximate the data ground truth PDF. And in order to update that, we kind of use the calculate the gradient, which would be the score. I mean, actually, yeah. Yeah. So in order to update previous model, we calculate the score for each parameter and then step into some kind of learnable learning rate to update the parameter setup to in order to make the this probability density PDF similar to the PDF. But the goal of the score model is to, oh, there's a typo here. No, not distribution. Learn the score. It means that we train a model to predict the gradient itself. So it's kind of different. The goal is different. Here we use the score to update the model, and here score is the one we try to predict. So that would be the main difference. And how to train score model is by using a Euclidean distance between the ground truth score and the predicted goal, and we call that a Fisher divergence, and which is expressed in this manner, in this equation. And here the problem is that we do not know the PDF of the data. We only have several samples of the data, which is independent and identical to each other. So we only just know very big samples, and we do not know the all probability density function. So it's kind of a problem, since in order to predict calculate this, we need to calculate the score. And since we do not know the PDF, we cannot find the gradient of the PDF. And fortunately, there's a paper that discussed about this problem, which was able to make some, what should I say, and loss term that does not dependent to the ground truth PDF. So yeah, I will not cover the details in here, but eventually we are now able to train this core model without knowing the PDF. But by tracing the gradient of the score model itself, which is the Jacobian of the score model. And also, for a quick recap, for those who do not know what's the gradient and Jacobian, gradient is in case of a scalar value function, so f rn to r, its gradient is a partial derivative of f at x. So it would be, for visualization, it will be like this shape in when we are training some previous network models like classifier or, you know, GANs or like that. We calculate the scalar loss and we backpropagate to get the gradient respect to the input, and based on that we update the model. And for the Jacobian, it's for the case of vector valued function. So it's just the same thing, but it's in a matrix form, since the function output of the function is not a scalar, it's a vector. So which means the Jacobian means the matrix form of a partial derivative. Anyway, yeah, I'll just move on for the mathematics. But you know, you guys not got the concept, right? Okay. So here, now, since we know how to calculate this part, now another problem is that this score matching is not really scalable for training, because since we are calculating the all of this, it is quite a lot computation compared to calculating a single just a gradient from a single scalar value. So in order to overcome this problem, Song et al. Has proposed a method paper called sliced score model, which projects the score into a one dimension. So the intuition is that since calculating the score and calculating the Jacobian of the score is kind of very computationally big and very hard, but it would be easier when it would be in the if the problem is formed in one dimension, not in two or three or multiple dimensions. So since if the GT score and the predicted score is identical enough, if we project into one dimension, like a line, single line, then the projected score would be also the same. And this is the idea. So they projected the score, calculated scores and GT scores into random directions every time and calculated. So the firm
Why is it possible again? After you projected in one dimensional space, why is it still working?
Why is it still working?
Yeah.
Because the score, if the score is the same, and if we just project it to some single dimension, one dimension, then it will be also the same. Like, actually, I did not really quite get the question about.
Yeah, so I mean, so the comp it's computationally demanding. So to reduce the computational burden, you project this information into one dimensional space.
Yes.
I'm not quite
Ah,
sure
so.
why is it still working after that. Because I mean, depending on where you project it, the value might be different. Depending on how you're gonna decide this one dimensional
Ah,
space.
yes. So actually, it's related to the implementation detail. So for in order to calculate the Jacobian, since we have, let's say, here is an input, and here is an some neural network here, like this connected, and then we have an output. So in order to calculate the Jacobian, we need to calculate all of this and make calculate the gradient, all gradient, and make it as a Jacobian form. So we need some several backpropagation, like here and there, here and there, here and there, which is required for each, should I say, the number of input dimension and output dimension. So it's quite a lot. But if we project it to a single dimension, which means like this, a network and output, we, let's say there's another single vector, we project it, and here we project it into single one, and here we have some projected result. And wait, actually this is covered in the after slide here. So in the final form of calculating this sliced score, sliced Fisher divergence, we need to calculate this one and this one. And for the formulation, this part, which used to be a Jacobian of the score model, becomes kind of this, which means if we do the fourth process and calculate this one, and from this part, we calculate the gradient. So it's based on, like, it's becoming a scalar to vector function, not vector valued function, scalar value function. And we take the gradient, and here we project it to the basis vector, which where we want to project it in a certain direction. And it gives this, so which means we only have to do one single forward and single backward. For the mathematical details, there's some details in this paper which derive the formulation of why this is mathematically correct, but actually I did not fully understand about those details. So in a brief manner and in simple implementation, for single forward and single backwards is enough to make a calculation for updating this Go model. So that's as far as I can go to explain now. So yeah.
Okay, oh yeah, one related question. I guess you briefly mentioned it, but then how do they determine the direction to project?
Ah, that direction is actually random, really a random set. So if the score is really identical, if we project it to any same direction, it will be the same. So
Okay.
we randomly set a direction and then use it to project the score and calculate this equation.
Okay.
Oh, can I ask you something? One more thing here.
Yeah, sure.
So can you go back one slide? So I understood that if the left and right are similar, then the projected one should be similar, right? But I think that's a too strong assumption. It sounds like because of course, if two spaces are similar, the projected one should be similar. But I think we cannot say that the projected ones are similar, then it should be same in, I mean, sorry, I should write
I
something.
think I kind of got your question. So since this score is a multi-dimensional vector, and since this is we are projecting into a one dimension, if the direction is similar, it would be okay. But if it's too complicated, this would not represent the all of the vector fields, right?
Yes, the similarity in the projected space cannot represent the same things in the higher dimension.
So that's why we use random directions. So we are not using only single direction. So every time we want to update, we randomly select a single direction from a set of random direction data set, should I say. We have a group of random directions, and we randomly select a single direction from it and use it to project the calculated score and the GT scores into that single dimension, and then calculate it. And then we use another direction to project it, and then another. So we are kind of, we can think it as projecting like medical imaging. We have a CT process, right? So there's a person lying here, and we use some kind of projector to slice it. So since this person is actually a three-dimensional object, we are projecting into kind of a single line, and then we evaluate, you know, everything.
Yeah, I think I got the
so
point. Thank you.
If we satisfy all these directions, then it would make it, the generated one would be similar to the ground truth.
Okay.
I hope my explanation was sufficient enough.
Yeah, I got the point. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh,
I have a question.
Yeah.
With this method, can this method increase the performance compared to previous work?
What do you mean about the previous work? Are you pointing about the previous generative models, or just the score matching, or?
For compared to first score matching models, using the trace of the score function directly.
Actually,
to solve the computation complexity problem, this model was shown. So compared to original, using trace of the score function model. This one can increase the performance.
Oh, model has some advantages, but then to do that, you have to compute the Jacobian matrices, which is computationally demanding. So suppose this author to work with the score model, they just introduced this new method to make the computation simpler.
Actually, in the reference I shown, there is a recorded video about the author Song Yang presenting about the question you asked, the quality or the performance improves or kind of thing. And I did not 그 가져오다 뭐죠? 그 I did not put that table in current presentation, but the table says that the slide score model is all performed as well as the previous score model, but it's much faster in calculating. So I think that is the what should I say, the main contribution and main benefit of the slice score model. So yeah, and also professor, I think he has also mentioned about the good point. Yeah, so thank you for the comment. And
yes, but my question was that to solve the computation complexity problem, they suggest the slice score model, but I'm curious about the performance. Is it also increase the performance?
Yeah, so performance is not really increasing here. It's about just minimizing the calculation while preserving the performance and accuracy of estimating the score. So it's not really improving the score matching itself. It's about reducing the calculation and make it scalable.
Thank you.
Yeah. And yeah, I should move on. And yes, and there's also another way to improve the score matching, which is denoising score model, which could be related to the diffusion model. And here is the idea is to add a noise to help the trait of Jacobian term. And here we say, let's say there's a P data, which is sampled from a ground truth data distribution X, and we perturb the noise using our own like 자유로 정하다 뭐 임의가 영어로 볼까요?
Arbitrarily.
Ah yeah, thank you. Arbitrary kernel, which is defined by a user, and we get this noise image. And since we have defined the kernel itself, it's easy to calculate the gradient of the noise perturbation kernel. And actually from here to here, there's a paper which derived and has a detailed information about this part. So I recommend you to read. But so eventually this is the final form of the term in order to minimize the denoising score matching. And it is also good to estimate the gradient with the noisy distribution. And since it's the method is about calculating a gradient dependent, I mean the related to the noise, it's not good for estimating the score of noise-free distribution, which is GT. So if we make the kernel small and small, we could closely approximate, but if the lower the magnitude of the noise, then the bigger the variance of denoising score matching objective becomes. And actually, this part, I did not really get the idea. So if there's someone who knows or who can better explain, I please interfere here.
I did not quite understand the relationship between noise and denoising and score model. So how is it related again? Score, why do you apply this noising and denoising to score model?
It's about calculating the, instead of calculating the Jacobian, it's using a noise to make the, this, actually, I don't know. I think if I in this part I did not fully understand about the reasoning of perturbing the noise here. So if what I say might not be accurate, so yeah, it's hard to explain it here. Yeah, I wish I could explain in more better.
Okay, so what is x and what is x tilde? Yes, so
x here is a ground truth image sampled from a data, and x tilde here is a noisy image.
Okay, so initially you have the distribution for the original ground truth data, and then given that information, you want to compute the probability of conditional probability of the noise
so
distribution.
So in my understanding, so from now, this is a fiction. So in my understanding, perturbing a noise is kind of, we can think it as a data augmentation. Since if we have a red, but fully red, but if we put some noise sampled from Gaussian distribution, depending on this size of the standard deviation, like white to black or something, then this data becomes kind of augmented a lot. So if there's only single data, then if you use the noise kernel, then it becomes quite a lot. So making the data augment, it is basically augmenting the data to make the distribution more, what is it, smoother, should I say? And in that way, we know the first distribution and the augmented distribution, and we know the difference by since we have selected some kind of arbitrary sigma of the noise, then we know the change, and somehow change of this equation, we only need to calculate the gradient of this, which is what we define here. So it's kind of more, much more small and easy to calculate and scalable. Yeah. And this is the end of the fiction. I'm not sure my explanation was correct, but that was my understanding of using the noise. Okay. So I'll move on. And since we have now covered about score model, which predicts the score from the data PDF, we are now gonna cover about sampling with the score. So our ultimate goal is to generate a new data. So how could we generate a new data using a score? Like this. So this, let's say this is a data sample, and by calculating a score matching, using a score matching, we train the model to predict the scores based, which represents the gradient of the log PDF of the data sample. And if we just naively sample and use it to follow the score, eventually it converges into a certain point. So only naively using scores and following it would not produce new data. It would converge into some kind of certain point. But what we want to do is to sample some new data, which is not covered in the given training data, team data. We want some images from here. But if we only follow the score, we would not be able to sample new, but we would only sample from several points, since the scores are the gradient where this point is where the gradient becomes zero. It's, yeah, where we converge. So in order to sample some plausible new data, we need a method to make the model sample from not from the converging point, but from somewhere else. And here comes the Langevin dynamics, which is the method that related to Brownian motion. And the Brownian motion, as far as I know, it related to calculating a particle motion, random particle motion. And by using the term from Langevin MCMC, which is Markov chain Monte Carlo, we were able to follow the score as well as we were able to sample the new data while following the scores, not converging into a single point. So then, can we generate the new data? Actually, no. So this is a training data set, which is CPAR-10 data.
Oh, by the way, I have a question in the previous slide. So yes? Why do you have all this dominant two directions, diagonally separated?
Ah, actually, this is a sample example PDF for the visualization. Here, we made some arbitrary distribution so that here and here.
We have two dominant groups?
Yeah.
So, okay, that's what I thought, but then the next slide.
Here?
Yeah, so we don't see any dominant grouping here. So
actually, this data does not represent this image. So it's entirely different. This is for just the visualization.
So
here,
if you computed scores from the next images in the next slide, then this the visualization will be totally different then.
Yes.
We do. Okay.
Yes. This was for the simple case where there's only two dominant points. Let's say like dog and cat. But this is actually, it has CIPA 10, so it has a 10 classes. So you would have much more 10 dominant. So you would have a different visualization. And coming back to the slide, only using Langevin dynamics and score cannot produce a plausible data. And for the reason, they say that there are several reasons like manifold hypothesis and data score is undefined. But actually, I did not fully understand and about these two parts. And the main reason they claim is that it is hard to estimate an accurate score function in a low density region. So here, this image is related to this kind of thing. So if we visualize the score, I mean the density, it will look like this. And here, this is the GT. And this is the estimated one. And if you, as you can see in the region box like this, where the data density is kind of high, the predicted result is kind of similar with the ground truth. But in the regions like here, where the density is very low, the direction, the scores are really different. So, and as well as the gradient scale is kind of big. So this, when the data is sampled here and follows the score in this inaccurate region, it might fall into somewhere else. So which might lead to inappropriate data like this. So in order to prevent this, we need to make the sampling, I mean, we need to guide this data to from data in a low density region to high density. We need some kind of a method to appropriately guide this direction. So in order to do that, previously we found that using a Gaussian, I mean, we perturbing the noise, we were able to make the distribution kind of like smoother. And by making it smoother, we were able to find some gradient in low density region to be much more fruitful, should I say? Yeah. So we are now using that here, method here. So we perturb the noise and make the density like this, much more smoother. And now predicted scores are much more similar to the ground truth score. So it's kind of good for our purpose. But in previous observation, score from noisy distribution is not really, it is useful to guide from low density to the high density, but the problem was that estimating the scores of noise-free distribution was impossible since the former equation was dependent to the size of the sigma. So for the noise-free distribution, which is the ground truth, we do not use the sigma here. So yeah, it was the problem. And in order to overcome this problem, the Song et al. Proposed this multiple noise level using multiple noise level. So this is an example of using three noise level. So this is a ground truth density, and we're gonna use three types of sigma to augment this data to make this three density distribution. And here, we're gonna estimate the score for each part and use it to guide the sampling process. And now, how should we estimate the scores for each noisy distribution? A simple way is to train a model, score model for each sigma. But in practice case, there would be we might need some more noise level more than three. We might need 1,000, we might need 2,000 or more. So in that case, we cannot train the score model for each sigma. So we need some alternative way. And in order to do that, noise conditional score model, 주동등장. This conditional score model gets additional input, which is the sigma we control. So when this sigma 3 is given with the data, it would predict the score based on this density. And when the score model is given with this sigma, it will produce the score based on this PDF. That is the idea. So we would only train single score model, which could cover all these different diverse sigma level, noise level. And the term changes from here to here. And oh, I forgot to tag the paper. Sorry for that. But yeah, this is the final form here, which we add up all the scores calculated here. And we weight it with the lambda dependent to the sigma, and then update the model. And this is the sequence of using this noise conditional score model to sample around to sample a new data from this distribution. And now we were kind of able to get some good results compared to the previous naive way of sampling. And now we're gonna look into controlling the sampling. So now we were able to sample the some plausible data from the given data distribution. And
before moving on,
yes,
really just simple question. So I still don't get like what is like the input of the generator or the
core model?
Yeah. So you're trying to generate data points. So there should be some input factor or something, but here I don't really get like what you're taking in as an input.
So the input is the data itself. So if we are taking an image data, if you are dealing with the image data, image itself would be an input, and we are gonna the score model will gonna predict a score which is a gradient of the probability distribution where the data point should move.
So
based on this score, which would be an output of this score model, we're gonna update this data to certain direction. And then we're gonna predict the score again, or this way or this way, and then gonna update, and it will be proceeded, so on and so on.
But what you're saying is that you're taking a photorealistic image or some kind of image as input.
For here, we're gonna take noise image.
So it's, a, it's
yeah.
like a random initialized tensor, I guess. Yeah, image. Okay.
Yep. And yeah, go back to controlling the sampling.
Can I ask one question?
Yes.
As far as I know, C410 is low dimensional image.
Yes.
And a sigma is one dimension, and it's given as an input. So if the image it becomes higher dimension, can it predict well, still predict well, because the effect of sigma will be low if the input parameter gets higher?
Very good question. And I think the same sigma would not result same performance when the given input's image size differs. Like sigma here for like 64 by 64 and 125 would have a different influence in noise perturbation. So for the case here, I think we need to use another sigma. I think. I'm not sure about this. Yeah. Actually, this answer was also a fiction.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. And yeah, there's also one more question.
I think I didn't understand the point why the adding the noise help the guide in the low dimensional low density region. Why does adding noise help guides on the low?
So okay, so here comes another fiction. So let's say there is three data here, and we wanna figure out the PDF of this data. But the PDF here, since we only have a three data points, it's kind of hard to estimate. So we are gonna augment it by applying noise. So in some schema case here, it will be like 이렇게 그러면 안 되는데. Wait. No, I think this explanation not good. So going back to the previous slide here, I think this figure represents the effect of perturbing the noise. So in very low density here, it is inaccurate since there is no like proper should I say slope?
Oh, thank you. I think I got the
What?
idea.
Miracle.
Thank you.
Okay. What? Yeah. Thank you for a quick understanding. Okay, coming back to controlling the sampling. So we want to specify the control signal of the sampling. Like we want to sample, let's say, if there's a distribution of cats and dogs here. And we want to only sample about the images from dogs, dog label. And here we use an additional model, which we assume as a, let's say, the classifier, classifying the produced data image into dog, predicting it as a dog or a cat. And since and so the X here is the image, and Y would be the label. So based on this, we could inverse this and to find this probabilistic inversion from this differentiable odd model of classifier. And in Bayesian rule, it will be calculated like this form. But if we put it into log and calculate the gradient, the denominator vanishes here, so we only need this gradient from unconditional score here and a gradient from the forward model here, classifier. So adding the gradient to the unconditional score we got here, we would be able to generate specific labeled image. And this is the idea of classifier guidance. Using a classifier to guide an unconditional score model to generate some kind of controlled images or controlled data. So for the visualization, I found it from Google, and I think this kind of well represents the procedure of classifier guidance process. One more time. We calculate the direction and we scale. Here, this is the scaling of the direction of gradient. And by adding it, we make it another one. And with the Langevin dynamics, we randomly move it and then calculate it again. And this is much more result in using a classifier guidance. So we here. The result is from a single score model, unconditional score model, guided by several classifiers, like for image embedding or colorization or image guidance. There will be each would have some kind of forward classifier model to give a guidance. And with the specific forward model, the single unconditional score model can be used in various domains. And this is a very 장점, good thing for the score model, as they claim. And there's also another method of not using a classifier, which is using two score models. One is for unconditional score, predicting a trained in unconditional way, and another one is training the model in with the label itself. So it's conditional score model. And this is the term of updating the data itself with the score. And if we unfold, should I say, 전개하다, the equation, it becomes like this. So in a simple visualization, we calculate a direction from certain data point with the conditional model and unconditional model. And we calculate the difference. And then we scale it into some way. And then we add it with the conditional vector and this one to make a new sampling. So in here, we do not use the additional or external classifier to guide this new condition controlling the signal. We use two score model with no classifier, and the same or better performance can be achieved. Yeah. Oh, and I also forgot to refer the paper. I'm sorry about that. And yeah. And for removing the classifier, why do we look for the classifier free guidance? Is that if you want to train or use it with the unconditional score model, it also needs to be trained with the noise level. Do you know what I mean? So here in the visualization, I mean the example, we trained with, in the example of three noise level, we trained in here. And for the classifier, in order to do the classifier guidance, we need a classifier also trained with this level, and this level, which means we cannot use the off-the-shelf classifiers, which is the only trained with the data. We need to make a new noisy distribution as well as the labeling and train the classifier to predict this noisy images refer to a certain label as well as this level and this level. So it's kind of also in efficient way, should I say? So that is the reason of proposing the classifier guidance. Yeah. And for, yeah, this. And for furthermore, I wanted to cover about score model with stochastic differential equation, but I was not able to prepare more slides after this. So maybe next time I would be able to cover this. So, and that was for all for my presentation here, and thank you for listening. Yes.